Coming up on the Wisconsin Vegetable Gardener Radio Show, we're going to discuss the mistakes that you might make in your garden this year, or ones that you've made that you don't even know you've made, and how to prevent them, as well as the pros and cons of starting your seeds versus buying them, and buying them versus starting them. As well as our guest this week, he is the author of the Straw Bale Garden Book, Mr. Joel Karsten will be with us. As well as your garden questions are always welcome on the ivyorganic.com hotline at 414-444-5250. And all of that starts right now.
You're tuned in to the only vegetable gardening radio show in Milwaukee with your host, Joey Baird, who grew up in the country but now lives closer to the city, and Hallie Baird, who has always been a city girl. Combined, they have over 25 years of gardening experience, who believe in simple gardening practices. A gardener for all gardeners, founders of the WisconsinVegetableGardener.com, where they created over 800 how-to garden videos to teach others how to grow more of what they eat. Join them for the next hour as they discuss vegetable gardening and more.
The digital magazine, and now we'll have this radio show.
Right. A number of ways in which you can contact us through the station here. You can call us on our Ivy Organic hotline, ivyorganic.com hotline, 3-in-1 Plant Guard, 414-444-5250. Holly's going to tell you a little bit about what Ivy Organic is. They're a primary sponsor here.
Ivy Organic is a 3-in-1 plant guard, naturally protects plants against damaging sunburn, insects, and rodents, protects newly installed plants and trees, shields pruned and damaged surfaces, for use on your roses, fruit, and nut trees, ornamental trees, and shrubs. This product is non-toxic, environmentally safe, and organic. For more information, visit ivyorganics.com.
We have a number of great sponsors that obviously make this program possible. It's not cheap to be on the radio, but we have worked with a number of companies, and we want to, you'll hear them throughout the program. The executive sponsor for the Wisconsin Vegetable Gardener Radio Program is Nasala Kombucha.
Nasala Kombucha is the executive sponsor of the Wisconsin Vegetable Gardener Radio Show. Nasala is made in Wisconsin with local tea and natural herbs. Look for it in the refrigerator aisle at your local grocer. If you don't see it, ask for it, because if it's not Nasala Kombucha, it's not kombucha. For more information, visit nasala.com.
If you are on the Twitter machine, you can certainly tweet us by using hashtag TWVG. We will see that pop up on our side. Even if you just want to say hi, how you doing? You can also email us at twvgradio@gmail.com. Those are two ways in which you can contact us, as well through the ivyorganic.com hotline. There's some things you want to know about us. If you want to tune in to CBS 58 tomorrow morning between 7 and 8 o'clock, CBS 58 has done a story on us. You can learn a little bit more about who we are and what we do. And then, you can interact with us even more in depth. So we do public talks each week, and if you would like to come see us, we will be at, where will we be at this week, Holly?
We're going to be in Brookfield at the Brookfield Public Library, and we are going to be there at 7 p.m.
March 9th, Thursday.
And what is our topic?
Straw bale gardening.
Right.
So our guest today is Joel Karsten. He is the author of the Straw Bale Garden Book. It's a new way, well, it's not really new, it's an innovative way in which you can grow without using soil. And we'll discuss with Joel the difference between hay and straw and why you might want to choose to grow this way versus growing in the traditional ground or raised beds or even containers.
Yeah, it's a really neat method and great method for gardening. So we'll talk to him at about 9:30.
Yeah, so if you'd like to come out and see us at the Brookfield Library, totally free. And if you've got a library, garden group, club, or other organization that you would like to have us talk at, you can find that information on our website, the WisconsinVegetableGardener.com. You can click under the speaking request, and you can also see the Come See Us tab. You can see where we're going to be throughout the city over the next 6-7 months. So you can do that, or you can just send us an email at twvgradio@gmail.com.
And if you have a question during our broadcast, you can tweet us, or anytime really, but you can tweet us at hashtag TWVG.
So I want to get into it, and you know, it's far too cold to be doing any gardening outside. So now's a perfect opportunity to talk about mistakes in which you have probably made, or might make, or will make, and you either know you're making them, or you don't know that you're making them. So we've got a list here that Holly and I have combined, because we've been doing this for a combined 27 years, from when we were kids to now. In the last 7 years, we've done this together. But we've made mistakes, knowingly and sometimes non-knowingly, and there's ways in which we want you to prevent from making your own mistakes. So,
right, so I guess it's basically common mistakes a lot of gardeners make, and they may or may not know that they're making them. And the first one I would have to say is planting things that they don't like, eat, or use.
Yeah, obviously, you know, why would you plant or spend the time or take the space in order to grow something that you are not intending or find out later you don't like?
And you may think this is common sense, but we hear this all the time. You know, my grandma planted okra, and this is what she did all the time, and all that. And I didn't like okra, so it's like, why are you planting it? So kind of think about what you're going to use, what you really enjoy. If you want to do a lot of saving of tomatoes, canning them, then plant a lot of tomatoes. But if you're not going to use that, then don't plant it.
Well, here's the thing. In order to know what you like, obviously we've all grown up with certain vegetables and fruits in which we enjoy. And there's always a list of fruits and vegetables in which we are curious about whether or not we like them or not. This is where the farmer's market, the organic grocery store, comes into play. And you can go, even though it may not be as wonderful and fresh as the homegrown stuff, at least you can get an ideal of what that tastes like, rather than spending 4, 5, 6 months trying to grow something in which you find out later that it's not as good as they once thought it would be. And you may have seen Pion Smith or Joe Lample or Martha Stewart grow this in their garden. You think, oh, that's really cool, that's fine and dandy, but you want to know what it tastes like, because you could put something else in that spot and make it much more viable and worth it your time.
Right. So that brings us to our next topic, which is planting the wrong crops, wrong time, wrong spot. And this happens a lot. People will get in this mindset that you start your garden in Memorial Day weekend. And that's not always true. There's a lot of plants that you are going to put in the ground in Memorial Day weekend, but there's a lot of plants you can start before then and even after then.
Right. We've got a number of seed starts, and we'll talk about this in the second topic, pros and cons to starting your own seeds versus buying them. But, yeah, you want to be able to plant. There's cool weather crops and there's warm weather crops. And they're designed by nature in which, let's take two examples, radishes and leaf lettuce. Cool weather crops designed to grow in the shorter length days, and this will work in the fall and in the spring and the fall. And once the day length gets longer, the plants realize this, and then they naturally go into a reproductive seed state, and then they're done. There are techniques in which you can exceed or extend your growing season to get leaf lettuce and some of the cooler weather crops, but trying to plant radishes and leaf lettuce in 85, 90 degree weather in dead of summer is not going to work. So you want to, you know, do a little research. You just don't want to go and buy some seeds and then, you know, throw them in the ground. And you need to understand the characteristics of each plant in which you're going to grow.
And it doesn't have to be, you don't have to have a huge deep knowledge in it, just a basic knowledge, like lettuce is a spring plant or a fall plant as opposed to something you were going to plant in July.
I want to touch on one thing I think a lot of people have struggled with, and that's growing onions. Regardless of where you're at, people have difficulty growing onions for a variety of different reasons. But the number one reason is because they're choosing the wrong variety of onion. There's three categories of onions, and we'll just focus on the easiest one, or the one that's designed for the northern areas, which is long day onions.
Right, so long day onions, you might think that doesn't make much sense, but it does, because during the peak of summer, we have longer days, essentially, and that means more sunlight for those onions. So you want to choose a variety that's a long day onion. Now, just because you go to your local garden center, home improvement store with a garden area, they might not have the correct onions for you. So you might have to do a little research and make sure that you have the correct onions that you need for long day onions.
Some of these companies are getting better, they are identifying, right. But if you go to your big box store here in Milwaukee and look at onions at the time that they're out, a lot of times they're going to be short day, neutral day, and long day. Mm-hmm. That doesn't define how long it takes to grow. They all grow the same. But if you try to grow short day in a long day area, if you try to grow the short day here in Milwaukee, you're going to get beautiful greens, magnificent greens. but you're not going to get any bulb development. The same thing is vice versa. So you want to get the long day onions when you grow them here in the northern areas, and that gives you the most opportunity to get large bulbs. And we'll talk more in the weeks to come. We'll be here for the next 34 weeks. So we'll always have a lot of conversations to have here about how to best execute your garden and get the most out of it.
So then another good thing, another thing that people don't necessarily think about is what's in their soil. So poor to no soil knowledge. Soil is the lifeblood of your plants. That's where your plants take up their nutrients. There's a lot of problems that could happen if your soil is not healthy or if there's problems in your soil. So it's good to know about your soil. I'm not saying you need to necessarily get a soil test, but you want to think, okay, I continually have this problem. And it may not be a pest, it may not be the plant, it might be the nutrients in your soil.
Soil tests can be relatively inexpensive. There's even tests in which you can purchase on Amazon and do the procedure, follow the instructions, and mail it off, and they'll email you the results. Obviously, with anything in life, the more money you spend, the more detailed information which you're going to receive on that soil test. But you want to figure out, and especially if you're starting a new garden this year, you want to do that because you may have high toxicities in your soil, high leads, that type of thing. And then you would want to figure that out because certain vegetables, there are some vegetables in which you can grow in soil that is toxic, but it's best to not grow them at all. Then you have the option of raised beds, container gardens, that type of thing, in order or straw bales, in order to have healthy plants.
Right, and if you're not sure about your soil and you think, okay, I know my neighbor says we have a lot of clay soil in this area, or maybe you live on a place that used to be a gas station, or you're not really sure what could be going on, there's always the option of raised beds, containers, and even the straw bales.
So with that, another one is inconsistent watering. That's a big issue when it comes to gardening, is the inconsistent watering. The old timers would rely on the rain. But we have more technology in which we can work with, and drip irrigation, that type of thing, where a lot of plants, tomatoes particularly, peppers also, that with inconsistent watering, it can affect the fruit development, and it has that rotten part. It's called blossom end rot. It's when the plant can't take up the necessary calcium in which to develop the fruit correctly, and that's why you have a beautiful tomato, and at the bottom, it's all rotten, because it doesn't have the right calcium availability in the soil. Your soil may have plenty of calcium. It's just the inconsistency of moisture that allows the plant can't pick that up. So we'll talk more about that, but that's another perfect example. If you have consistent water, a damp soil, the plant's going to have the availability and the microbes to give the plant what it needs.
Right. So,
we got time for one more.
Okay, so why don't we talk about taking on too much? This is a common situation, especially if you're a new gardener. You're like, yes, I'm going to garden this year. I have this 10x10 spot in my backyard. It gets good sunlight. I'm ready to go. And then all of a sudden, halfway through the season, you're like, what did I do? And it happens, and it's okay. But so think about maybe if it's your first year or something, or you're wanting to expand, think about what you can expand within reason.
A great way to start a garden is simply go a raised bed. You're going to bring in some soil. Yes, it's a small expense investment, but you're going to eliminate the weeds if you do this right. You're going to eliminate the weeds. You're going to have good soil, so you don't have to worry about the toxicities in the soil. And you're going to have, let's say, a 4x4, which is 16 square feet. You can grow a lot in 16 square feet. So that being said, you want to start something small like that and work your way up. Obviously, with our gardens, when you follow our videos on the WisconsinVegetableGardener.com, we have three gardens. We help two individuals guard them. We have a garden at our residence. We have a garden at Holly's backyard, mother's backyard, and Holly's sister's backyard. So we kind of maintain two and help with one. But that's about 2,000 square feet. So with that being said, I grew up on a farm, so I understand a little bit more about land management than the typical urban individual might. So I understood how to take care of that and manage it and break it up in portions in which we can do it and do it successfully.
And we've learned some things along the way as well.
So, yeah, with that being said, these are just some of the thousands upon thousands of mistakes in which gardeners make. And sometimes you know that you're making them and you go ahead and turn your head and do it anyway. And sometimes you don't know you're making them. And the end result continues to be the same year after year. So with that, you know, we want to help you be the best gardener you can be. After the break, we're going to discuss the pros and cons, whether you should start your seeds indoors or buy them at the garden center. Right back after this.
Tweet Joey and Holly using hashtag TWVG.
The number one key to healthy, productive plants are the roots. Starting from seed to full-grown plants, RootMaker.com has the answer. From seed starting trays with an innovative design that air prunes the roots, creating a fabulous root system, never again will you have root-bound plants, to multiple gallon grow bag sizes to raised beds. RootMaker.com has your grow needs covered. Visit RootMaker.com.
Do you have a little space to grow? Check out Greenstock Vertical Gardens at GreenstockGarden.com. Greenstock is engineered to grow with its innovative space and water-saving design. You can grow vegetables, flowers, herbs, and even strawberries in just 2 square feet of space. Grow up instead of out. Perfect for the porch, patio, or deck. Grow up to 30 plants in a small space. GreenstockGarden.com has everything you need to grow in the littlest of spaces. Proudly made in the USA. For more information and to purchase, visit GreenstockGarden.com. Beans and Barley Marketing Cafe, a neighborhood specialty grocery store for the east side and greater Milwaukee area, where you can find all you need, from fresh produce to bakery to organic frozen dinners, from wine to fresh squeezed carrot juice, a health food store with hundreds of products, vitamins, supplements, bath and body items, magazines, cards, books, and a knowledgeable staff. Catering available, open daily at 8 a.m. The restaurant serves breakfast, lunch, and dinner 7 days a week with a menu of good, healthy, homemade food, including vegetarian and non-vegetarian specialties. 1901 East North Avenue, Milwaukee, 414-278-7878, and online at beansandbarley.com. Really Granola is a small-batch Wisconsin-made granola available at reallygranola.com. This granola uses many organic ingredients and features Wisconsin products such as beautiful red Wisconsin cranberries, local honey, and other delicious Wisconsin products. You'll find plenty of fiber and protein in Really Granola, which makes it a great way to start or end your day. This granola is baked in a Wisconsin co-packing kitchen that helps to employ disabled workers. Find Really Granola near you or to buy online, visit reallygranola.com.
Now back to the Wisconsin Vegetable Garden Radio Show with your hosts, Joey and Holly Baird.
Welcome back to the program. Welcome back to the program. We are happy that you have joined us. Have you told your friends and family that the Garden Radio is back on the airways, being produced in Milwaukee after nearly an 11-year absence? So let them know. Well, you're probably not going to talk to them because we do social media so much. Just send them a Facebook message or a text.
Hashtag.
860 AM WNOV and 106.5. We're on the air for the next 35 weeks. We're going to get into pros and cons of starting your seeds indoors or buying them. But first, we want to have a message from our good friends from TreeRipe.com.
So TreeRipe Citrus, if you like fresh produce delivered right to your neighborhood, you should check out TreeRipe Citrus Company. You can find out where to pick up top quality produce from tree-ripe.com. They have beautiful, tasty peaches and juicy, sweet blueberries. If you're sick of bland, mealy peaches and lackluster blueberries from your local grocer, TreeRipe has what you need. They come right to a stop in your neighborhood, fresh off the truck, right from the source. For location and schedules, visit tree-ripe.com. They have locations all over, including Upper Iowa, Upper and Lower Michigan, Minnesota, Illinois, and right here in Wisconsin. Tree-ripe.com is your go-to for the freshest produce around.
Well, we've gotten from Tree Ripe a number of years, haven't we, Holly? We usually get the peaches. You got what? What did you get one time? Nectarines, or not nectarines?
Citrus.
Honeybells. Yeah, I mean, just absolutely phenomenal. Big juice. I mean, they're almost, some of them are bigger than baseballs. I mean, phenomenal fruit from Tree Ripe. So keep that in mind. Wonderful sponsors we have for the program. So many people, when it comes to gardening, many people just go to their garden center. and buy some starts and bring them home and plant them in the ground, which is perfectly fine. But there's some pros and cons in which are that's good as well as that's bad. And we're going to discuss some of those pros and cons, and you can always feel free to tweet us using hashtag TWVG if you've got how you garden, whether you buy the starts or start them indoors with seeds. So here's some of the, there's a number of pros and cons here, Holly. We've just listed a few of them. One pro to buying your seeds is, buying your starts is it's easy.
Right.
You just go and buy and plant them.
Mm-hmm.
One of the cons to starting your seeds indoors is you need space. And
right.
There's some equipment that you need to use to get your seeds going. And it's a small investment. I mean, you're going to need some kind of potting soil. You're going to need something
to grow them in.
Right.
But you could also spend, you know, fall and winter saving things like your yogurt cups, your sour cream containers, or whatnot as well.
Right. And that's an easy way to go. Now, there's some techniques in which you need to do that. And if you really want to take it to the next level, you can get a grow light, or you can just set them on the windowsill. There are some finessing that has to be done with certain plants in order to get them to grow the best they can indoors. With that being said, the con to buying the starts from the garden center is simply this. Garden centers only have, the place in which they purchase these plants from, have a limited selection of plants. Just a small variety. When you start your seeds indoors, you have dozens, if not sometimes hundreds of different varieties in which you can choose from. Perfect example is tomatoes. You go to the garden center, they maybe will have, let's pick a number, 20 varieties available at the garden center. Well, that's cool. I know some garden centers have about 25, 30. Okay, 25, 30 different varieties. Seems like a lot. But if you decide to start your tomato seeds indoors, on the market, well, worldwide, there's about 9,000 different varieties of tomatoes. Obviously, they're not all available on the market. But literally, there are hundreds and hundreds of available seeds to be purchased for you to start inside on for your garden. So you can go to the garden center and buy 20 or 30 different varieties, or you can start your own seeds indoors and have the choice of a couple hundred.
Right.
And now, not all of those seeds will, or not all of those, we're using tomatoes because that's one of the most common vegetables that people grow in their garden.
But if you like peppers.
Peppers.
A lot of people like different varieties of hot peppers, and there's probably only going to be like jalapenos and maybe habaneros at your local garden center.
Well, yeah, some of these things that will, you know, eat the paint off the hood of your car.
Right.
You kind of specialty order for that. So what are some other, space. You're going to need space.
You're going to need space, yeah. But some good things about starting your own seeds is you can, like you spoke about, you can choose a variety. It's actually the cheapest way once you get past the investment of that potting soil and what you're growing in. It is the cheapest way because you can buy a pack of 100 seeds for a buck, pretty much.
Right, on the low end.
Right, on the low end. And then you...
Timing. We got to get this timing thing down.
Right.
Because you just... And there's certain seeds in which you do not start indoors. It's just... For people who are starting out gardening, they have no idea. They decide, you know, they see on TV or YouTube or internet, you know, oh, you start all these seeds indoors. Well, for example, radishes and carrots, you don't start indoors because they're root crops. They do not transfer or transplant nicely at all. Plus, the radishes only take about 21, 30 days, so why would you start them indoors, okay?
Well,
and that's sometimes we make mistakes,
right.
Okay? It's a learning thing. But also, you know, most vegetables, let's say the brassicas, the kohlrabi, the cabbage, the broccoli, the cauliflower, the Brussels sprouts, 6 to 8 weeks before your last average frost date. Onions, 10 to 12 weeks before your last average frost date, or when they're recommended to be started indoors or in a greenhouse. Tomatoes, 6 to 8 weeks. Peppers, I think it's 8 to 10 weeks. So you've got to get this thing down. And just because you see one chart on the internet doesn't mean that chart is right. That chart may have been designed for the specific location in which that blogger...
But there are good ones.
Oh, true. Yes, they're very,
like,
very good ones. Farmer's Almanac.
Farmer's Almanac is a great...
And it all determines about what zone you are in. That's the growing area. And for most of us in the southern, southeast, the Milwaukee area, we're in zone 5, 5A, 5B, somewhere in that range. So that would be a good guide.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've started seeds far too early, and we started seeds far too late. So we finessed this. obviously that's a guide, but you can tweak it as you wish when it comes to planting seeds indoors and getting them started to transplant them out. You also have to harden them off.
Yeah, that does take a little bit of work. So,
and some people do not understand. Explain, Holly, what hardening off a plant is.
Basically, you're acclimating that plant to the weather or the new conditions. So it's been inside your happy home, happy little plant, maybe under the grow lights or by a nice window, and it's basically temperature controlled. And now you're getting ready to move that plant outdoors where it's going to face some rougher conditions, and you're essentially getting it acclimated to the different conditions.
Right, you're taking out for a short period of time, bring it in, taking out, bring it in over a duration of a week. It's just like you getting out of a hot shower into a cold room. It's that shock. Well, plants are much more susceptible to that shock, and they don't come back necessarily sometimes at all. And also the sun and all that. And we'll get into all that more as we get closer to the planting season here in the Milwaukee area. What other things that are pros and cons to starting seeds indoors versus the planting or buying them at the garden center?
Sure. So your seeds are going to eventually become more acclimatized to your area. And
that simply
means that as you continue to grow that seed year after year, it's going to get used to your specific area of growing. So right now, when you purchase a seed and you start it, it's just a good seed to grow. And over time, if you save that seed year after year, it's going to be used to your conditions. Maybe if you have a shorter growing season, it's going to get used to that.
And you touched on this a few moments ago, bigger yield for less money.
Right.
When you start your seeds, this is a pro for starting seeds indoors. And I know not everybody has the availability, the capability, or wants to go through the time and effort in order to start seeds indoors. Now, we'll start somewhere around about 800, 900 plants indoors, okay?
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy, I understand that. For the common, ordinary backyard urban gardener, that's insane. But we take things to the utmost extreme on a lot of aspects of gardening, but we want to show you that it is perfectly accessible. But when we talk about that, one of our sponsors is M.I. Gardner. He's a seed seller. He's got a seed store in Michigan. You can buy 1,000 carrot seeds for 99 cents, okay? That's a lot of carrot seeds for 99 cents. You can buy 25 tomato seeds for 99 cents. And the same variety in which he has, you can buy from a competitor for $5.
Well, more like $3.
Well, $4.99, okay,
right.
$4.95,
well,
yeah.
Depends on where you buy it.
Right.
It's on sale.
But what I'm saying is a little investment goes a long way. You're not going to plant, most people are not going to plant 1,000 carrot seeds. And carrot seeds, if you take care of the seeds, you're going to get maybe 2 years out of the viability of the seeds. The seeds are still good. And that's just some of the pros and cons to starting your seeds indoors. Now, Holly, it's cold outside right now, but it's going to get warm. And for most people, we cut grass, and most people don't have a lawnmower in which they really are proud of. So we need to look at that, and we might as well get the best on the market, right?
Right. That's right. So do you hear that? That's your neighbor shaking in their grass-stained shoes, because Arians is about to help you step up your grass-cutting game. Your name is on the mailbox, so the Arians name should be on your mower. Heavy-duty steel construction, smarter, smoother controls, professional cutting performance. The only thing we love more than the smell of freshly cut grass is the sweet taste of victory. Arians, it comes down to this. Visit Arians.com to find your local dealer for lawn and snow removal equipment.
So we'll be right back after these messages from our great sponsors, and Joel Karsten, author of the Straw Bale Garden Book, will be with us to answer all of our questions about what is a straw bale and how do you grow in it.
Have a gardening question? Email Joey and Holly at twvgradio@gmail.com.
You say? You say Nasala Kombucha. It'll put some glide in your stride and some pep in your step. Nasala Kombucha. Yeah.
Nasala. Sala kombucha makes your body happy. Nesala kombucha makes your body smile.
Mycorrhizae is a beneficial fungus from plantsuccess.com that will greatly increase your plant's germination ability and a healthier root structure. You can increase seed sprouting, root growth, and general plant germination. Mycorrhizae can be used with hydroponics, root cutting, seed sprouting, coca core, and soil. PlantSuccess.com carries powder, granule, and tablet forms of mycorrhizae. Increase the level of mycorrhizae in your soil for your plants to give them the optimal opportunity to produce an incredible harvest. For more information and to purchase, visit PlantSuccess.com.
Garden seeds do not have to cost a fortune. Just 99 cents at migardener.com. With over 300 varieties of non-GMO, heirloom, and organic flower, vegetable, and herb seeds available year-round, pay less and get more seeds. Shipping as low as $2.50. That just makes sense. Go to migardener.com for seeds and gardening needs, tools, and special blend fertilizer. migardener.com. It's that simple. Family owned and operated. Mantis Plant Protection Professional Grade Organic Pest Control Solutions. They offer Mantis EC concentrated or ready-to-use sprays. Certified organic and environmentally friendly insect killer. Gentle on pollinators and other organisms, but effective in killing soft-bodied insects and spider mites fast. Safe around your children and pets. They also have the cleanest and whitest diatomaceous earth on the market. Visit MantisPP.com to receive a free organic pesticide cheat sheet, which is a list of organic insecticides that are used effectively and kills insects fast. Visit MantisPP.com to download it today.
Now back to the Wisconsin Vegetable Garden Radio Show with your hosts, Joey and Holly Baird.
Welcome back to the Wisconsin Vegetable Garden Radio Program. I am Joey Baird, and across from me is my wife, best friend, co-host,
Holly Baird.
Behind the WNOV 860 AM and 106.5 FM microphones. If you want to contact us, you can contact us through the Ivy Organic 3-in-1 Plant Guard Hotline at 414-444-5250, as well as you can tweet us using hashtag TWVG, or you can email us at TWVG radio at gmail.com, TWVGradio@gmail.com, and that's anytime you want to send us a question. It doesn't have to be when we're on the air. We want to bring in our guest this week. He is the author of a multi-award-winning and multi-translated book from all over the country.
All over the world.
Mm-hmm. All over the country, all over the world. The Straw Bale Garden Book Complete. His name is Joel Karsten. He was a farm boy in the great state of Minnesota, and he discovered that this was a way that maybe people should figure out how to grow, and that's been 24 years ago. We want to welcome you to the program, the Wisconsin Vegetable Garden Radio Program, Mr. Joel Karsten.
Hi, Joey. Hi, Holly. How are you this morning?
Doing well. We thank you for taking time out of your busy day to talk with us and our listeners about straw bale gardening.
Well, there's no place I'd rather be on this lovely Saturday morning than on your inaugural show. I'm glad to be on.
Well, we appreciate that. Now, for many people who didn't have a farm or agricultural background,
like
Holly,
right,
and many of our listeners, what is the difference between straw and hay, and which is the preferred method in order to grow vegetables in?
Well, that's sort of a leading question. Let's start out with what's straw and what's hay. Straw is what's left over after the small grain or the cereal grain harvest. So you cut your oats or your wheat once it gets mature, and or your barley, and you remove the seed heads. That becomes wheaties and oatmeal, of course, and then you bale up the stalks. And in agriculture, usually those stalks are used for bedding material for livestock. That's what they sleep on. Hay is a little different. Hay is baled grass or baled alfalfa. So you go right out in the field and cut it. You don't remove the seeds. You want the seeds included because that's nutrients for your livestock. So we consider hay to be fodder, where straw is bedding material. They'll chew on a little bit of straw, but most livestock doesn't derive much nutritional value from straw because there's not a lot left in it in terms of seeds. So they eat the hay. They sleep on the straw. Hay is green. Straw is gold or yellow colored. Hay is a little heavier, straw is a little lighter. Hay is, in our part of the world, in your part of the world, hay is a little more expensive. Straw is a little less expensive. Now, over the years, the reason I started using straws because it was less expensive. But certainly hay will work for this process. You know, it's not exclusive just to straw. I call it the Straw Bale Gardens method because that's sort of what it was when it started out. But we use this method on either straw or hay or other substrates as well. It doesn't have to be just straw or just hay. I have people in other parts of the world that use what is their local organic material, whatever they have an excess of. For instance, in Dominican Republic, they use sugarcane stalks, which are squeezed through the rum making process. They get all the juice out, and then what remains are these sort of shredded stalks, and they bale those up real tight, and they make vegetable gardens in those. So they use that as a substrate, but you know, it can really be pretty much anything, as long as it's organic material that's going to decompose. So anything you would normally put into a compost pile, you could use to make your own bale, to make a straw bale garden, using the Straw Bale Gardens method on a bale of whatever material that might be. So hopefully that clears it up.
Okay. Now, where can somebody find a straw bale?
Well, you know, any farmers, you know, that's always a good place to start. I always tell people, you know, if you just know one farmer, that's all you have to know, because all the farmers know all the other farmers. Just like if you ask a teacher, they know all the other teachers, and the nurses know the other nurses. Usually the farmers know most of the other farmers. And they'll steer you in the right direction. You know, they know from driving around who grew wheat or who grew oats last year, and whoever grew oats or wheat is going to have a barn filled with some straw. So that's a good place to start. You know, if you're going to buy retail, you can go to a garden center. Support your local independent garden center, buy from them. Alternatives, you could use Craigslist. Believe it or not, people have found that selling and buying straw bales on Craigslist is a great resource. We also have a website that I started called strawbalemarket.com, and that's a great place. If you're a farmer and you want to sell bales, I have a number of farmers from around Wisconsin that have ads on there to offer their bales for sale, and it's just a free website, so there's no cost to put your ad on there. There's no cost to use the website to find a supplier of straw. We just, as part of my service to the country, to the world, actually, it's a worldwide database. I just built that website, and then I just do real minor support to that website because it pretty much runs itself. People create their own ads, and after a period of time, of course, the ads expire, but. So it's a good resource as well. You know, and sometimes when you become a straw bale gardener, Holly, as you drive around, you're going to find straw bales. You know, you just kind of run across them. At Christmas time, you'll see the church up the street that uses straw bales for a nativity scene outside. And, you know, come February or so, those straw bales are looking pretty ragged. You'd be surprised if you knock on the door and ask them, hey, what are you doing with those bales? They'll say, oh, geez, we were going to pay somebody to come and take them away. Why don't you go ahead and take them? That's fine. We're not even going to charge you for them. So we don't care if the bales have been outside. You know, if somebody used them for insulation around their house or whatever, or over their drain field or their well cover or whatever. Sometimes people cover that with bales of straw or old bales of hay. Those are just fine for us. Those will work just fine.
Now, the advantage to growing in straw bales is that you can place them pretty much anywhere, even in places in which a traditional, well, they're kind of like a container, aren't they, Joel?
Right. Yeah, that's what I tell people, Joey. Think about the bale as a container garden. You know, the outside of the bale, over a period of time, when you get sunshine and you get the wind that blows on that bale, the outside dries out very quickly. So even when that bale gets wet, when you water it or when it gets rained on, the outside layer dries out quickly. And over a long period of time, over the summer, that outside layer sort of forms a crust because it decomposes much more slowly. The inside of the bale stays nice and wet and begins the process of decomposition very quickly. Now, it would do that all on its own. If we just walked away and left it, it would decompose on its own. But with a straw bale garden, we're going to speed that process. We're going to encourage that decomposition. And we do that, of course, by growing bacteria inside the bale. And that's part of what we do the conditioning process for on the bale, is to feed that bacteria. And then inside the bale, it becomes soil. That's what I try to explain to people. The big misnomer about straw bale gardening is everybody thinks you're growing vegetables in straw, and you're really not. You're growing vegetables in very recently decomposed straw. which is very different than what the straw was when it started out. It really becomes early stage soil or compost inside that bale. And that's where the big advantages begin of the straw bale gardening method.
So there's a lot of things you can grow in the straw bales. I know it's a lot easier to ask, what can you not grow in a straw bale?
Or what should you not grow in a straw bale?
Yeah. Well, that's a good question. You know, if we're talking specifically about our area here in Wisconsin, Minnesota, I really don't recommend people grow sweet corn. You know, you're going to get about 3 or 4 stalks of corn because the roots on corn, if you've ever noticed, are huge. And it takes, you know, it sucks up lots of nutrient value out of that bale and limits what else you could plant. You know, and if you got, say you've got 5 stalks of corn and each one gave you, you know, 1.5 years, you'd get 7/8 years of corn. It's just not efficient. You know, if you're going to pay, you know, any amount of money at all for that bale, it's not very efficient. So I don't recommend corn. And I also don't recommend planting things that are perennial roots like asparagus and rhubarb, things that come back year after year from the same root stock. Remember, in 3 years, that bale will be unrecognizable in your garden. It will be completely decomposed. It will have become a little lump of soil, and that's about it. And therefore, your asparagus or rhubarb is going to be planted up on top of a hump in your garden, and you don't want that. You know, you want it to be nice and level. So if you're going to do something like asparagus in a straw bale garden, you could start it in the bale, but I would encourage you to dig about 1/3 of the bale into the ground, make a little trench, put it down in there, so that when it decomposes completely, that asparagus will be level with the ground. And that way, when you water it, the water won't all run off of the hump. And you need to wait 3 years before you can start harvesting asparagus or harvesting rhubarb, because they need to establish roots for 3 years before you should really ever start harvesting any of the production. So for those types of crops, you could grow it, but it's probably not something that you're going to harvest out of the bale, and it's not something that I recommend. Other than that, almost everything does well. I've noticed that rosemary doesn't seem to thrive in a straw bale garden. It will persist, but it doesn't love that environment. The other thing that I haven't had extreme success with is onions. I haven't gotten great performance from onions. And other crops will be, you know, sort of, some years I just, you know, you can't beat the production, and then the next year your production's about the same as it would be in a typical soil garden. You know, it doesn't give you the extraordinary extra amount of production like we're used to with straw bale gardening. And one of the reasons that happens is because those bales get warm inside, and that vegetables really love that.
Now, you've touched on it just briefly here. For people who are listening to the program who have never heard about growing in a straw bale before, what are some of the reasons why you would encourage people to grow it this way versus a traditional garden method?
Well, I'll tell you the number one reason I get from people as feedback why they love straw bale gardening, without me leading them to this conclusion, they all come back and tell me, oh my goodness, I went all summer and I had a vegetable garden and I didn't pull a single weed out of my whole garden. It really can be a completely weed-free way to produce vegetables. And for most vegetable gardeners that I know that are traditional soil gardeners, that's the worst part of the vegetable gardening process, is you got to be very vigilant about keeping your garden weed-free. And for anybody who's never had a vegetable garden that might be out there listening, if you just go out and take a rototiller and you till up your sod and, you know, prepare your soil and then you plant the row of peas or beans, you're going to stand back, and about a week later, you're going to see this green carpeting coming up everywhere in your garden. Along with your beans or peas, up is going to come a whole bunch of grass and weeds and other things, because your topsoil, no matter where you are on planet Earth, your topsoil has weed seeds in it. They blow in the wind. You know, they come in with animal manure or animal droppings in your area that are undigested seeds, and that's Mother Nature's way of allowing plants, weeds, to spread themselves, to reproduce, as it goes through the digestive tract of animals or livestock or whatever. And then, of course, we use that for fertilizer, and it spreads it everywhere. Or you see your neighbor's dandelions that that little white cloud that comes off of their front yard, that white cloud is all full of dandelion seeds, and they're heading to your garden to end up in the topsoil. So, you know, you're going to constantly fight reoccurring every year all these weed seeds. Even if you go out and pull every single weed in your garden and you don't have a single weed all summer, which I know that's the way your garden looks, Holly, I'm sure, and Joey. Even if you do that, next year you're still going to get weeds that will come back. Where, remember, with the straw bale, we're starting with stalks of wheat, not seeds, but hopefully the seeds have been removed and you just have stalks left. So as they decompose, they become new soil inside the bale, but there are no weed seeds in there. If there are any seeds left from the wheat harvest or the oat harvest, and they're in the interior of the bale, it's highly likely that they'll be digested by the bacteria during this conditioning process, and they won't sprout anyway. They'll be heat treated, because these bales get really hot as they begin to decompose, and that sterilizes those seeds. Now, you might get a couple sprouts on the outside edges of the bale, and that, you know, kind of looks like you got a little peach fuzz growing out of the top of your bale. If that happens, I tell people, just grab your bottle of vinegar and squirt those sprouts with a little bit of vinegar, and it gets rid of them, and then you're done. Essentially, you don't have another weed to pull all summer. So that's the biggest advantage, above all, is the fact that it's weed-free. Now, there are some obvious things. You can look at a bale, and you can see it's raised up off the ground. So anybody who has any kind of physical limitation that can't easily get down to the ground, this is a great way to have a raised height garden without the expense and the commitment level of a traditional raised bed garden. You know, if you have terrible soil and you can't produce anything in the soil you have, this is a great alternative. We have tons of people in Arkansas that do this because they all live on granite down there and they can't grow gardens because they don't have any topsoil to speak of. So this is a great way for them to do it. If you live and you only have concrete around you or asphalt, you can do this on concrete or asphalt, or you can do this on your rooftop. I have a lot of Europeans, particularly in the Netherlands and Germany and France, that are gardeners on their rooftop, and they do straw bale gardens because it's very convenient. Bales are lightweight to carry up on the roof compared to, you know, 40-pound straw bale compared to 500 pounds of soil. If you took the same volume of soil and tried to carry it up there, is a really big difference. For your back and for the building itself. So, you know, if you got a lot of bales up there, it translate that to soil, you'd have a heavy, heavy roof. So, you know, there are many other advantages also that, you know, we can get into talking about. But for northern gardeners like us, probably one of the other biggest ones is that the bales get warm as they decompose, and the roots of the plants love that, early in the season especially.
That's great. Now, before we let you go, let us know where we can find your book, the best way to purchase it.
Well, you can go to your website. You can buy it on your website, WisconsinVegetableGardener.com. And I know you guys sell the book. You guys are also instructors for straw bale gardening. So if anybody over there is looking for somebody to come and give a seminar or teach a class or something, they can reach out to you guys. And you'll do it. But if they want to buy it specifically from me, they can come to my website, which is strawbalegardens.com. They can always find it there. You know, and if you just Google straw bale gardening, you'll find me. I'm pretty much everywhere online. So, you know, everything eventually leads back to me, since I'm the one who sort of pioneered this method. Lots of other people talk about their straw bale gardening methods that they use, but most of them all derived originally from what I originally did. So, yeah, you know, it's easy to find. Any bookstore carries it. You can buy it online, lots of places. So, but if you want an autographed copy, come to your website or my website and buy it there.
And we will have those books available when we talk at Brookfield this Thursday at 7 o'clock here in Milwaukee. Joel, it's been a great opportunity to visit with you and for you to share the information about a unique way of growing a garden, not using traditional methods.
Thank you, Joel.
Thank you. Thanks so much for having me. I just want to say also that I think you guys are doing a great thing for vegetable gardening in general, and especially for, you know, Wisconsin people and Minnesota people. You know, for those of you out there in your audience who don't know it, Holly and Joey are doing just an amazing job of teaching people about vegetable gardening. Really, you know, some of the content you guys produce is amazing stuff, and you do just a super job. So,
well, thank you very much. We appreciate that.
You bet. Have a great day. Thanks so much, you guys.
You too.
And we'll be right back after this with more of your questions.
Have a gardening question? You can call into the ivorganic.com hotline at 414-444-5250 right now.
Do you have a problem with deer or small herbivores eating your vegetation? There is a natural solution that is safe for your pets and family. Bobex is the answer. An environmentally friendly solution to protect your plants, will not wash off, and is guaranteed. Bobex Deer was independently tested against 9 known competitors and rated 93% effective, second only to a physical barrier. Bobex can be used on all types of ornamentals, trees, and shrubs. Ask for it by name at your local independent garden center. Find out more, visit bobex.com. bobex.com.
Eating natural and organic is not as expensive as it used to be, especially when you shop at Whitman's. They have aisles full of certified organic food, from fruits and vegetables to dairy products and even meat, all at great prices. They even have a huge selection of wheat-free and gluten-free items. I can come to Whitman's and get everything I need all under one roof. My name is Alicia, and I shop at Whitman's.
Do you want your next raised beds to be easy, functional, and beautiful? The Embrace helps you create the garden you've always wanted. Finally, raised beds that everyone can assemble and enjoy. No tools needed. Just slide any lumber into the Embrace corner, fill with your favorite soil mix, and you're ready to plant. Made from 100% recycled steel right here in the USA. And a portion of every sale helps to build school and community gardens all across the country. Let the Embrace help you create your next raised bed. Grow beautifully with the Embrace, available at local garden centers and online at artofthegarden.net.
Hotshot Mill, 125 years of experience producing stone ground organic flour and cornmeal made from premium quality whole grains. Family owned company, continual standards that are non-GMO, organic at the highest safety levels, offering a wide variety of flours, pasta, baking mixes, flaxseed, and more, even kosher and gluten-free options. Found at most local grocers like Woodman's. For more information and recipes, visit hotchinmill.com. That's HODGSONMILL.com.
Now back to two gardeners who don't claim to know a thing about golfing.
I mean, we don't golf, so we're not going to listen to podcasts about golf or watch television shows on how to golf.
Joey and Holly Bear.
Well, we don't know how to golf, and we don't claim we do either. On the ivorganic.com hotline, you're welcome to call in with your question before the top of the hour, 414-444-5250, Ivy Organic 3-in-1 Plant Guard Protection.
So the Ivy Organic 3-in-1 Plant Guard naturally protects plants against damaging sunburn, insects, and rodents, protects newly installed plants and trees, shields pruned and damaged surfaces for use on your roses, fruit and nut trees, ornamental trees, and shrubs. This product is non-toxic, environmentally safe, and organic. For more information, visit ivorganics.com.
We have a caller on the line. Caller, you got a question or comment?
Yes, I was calling. I was wondering if you put weed kill and put new soil in there, would that pull the weeds out or calm them down a little bit?
If we put weed kill, what do you refer to weed kill? Like a barrier or a chemical?
Well, you know, like the weed, not weed and grass, but just weed kill, you know, because I do get a lot of weeds in my garden once I plant. And I was wondering if I put weed kill in there with some new topsoil in there, tilted real good, would that kind of calm the weeds down?
Well, here when we till, what we're doing, there's thousands of seeds that are viable in the soil, and when we till, we're introducing them into an environment in which they can grow better, and some seeds can lay dormant for up to 80 years. So by incorporating that weed kill and then putting more soil on top of it, what I would recommend is you can use that weed kill and then just put 2 or 3 inches of good compost on top of that and then plant into that compost, and over the year that compost will work down in the soil and help fertile the soil, but also it's creating a barrier between the native soil and the new soil you're bringing in and hiding a lot of those weed seeds to prevent them from germinating. Your other option, if you're going to till, is what happens a lot of weeds in which grow in your garden. When you cut the roots up, they propagate from the roots. So you may have one wiregrass. I call it a wiregrass. It's got a lot of roots. You pull that out, and you get rid of it, you get all the roots out of it. But when you go in and till, you're cutting all those roots up, and now instead of having one plant, you come back in 2 weeks and you've got like three dozen plants, because each one of those follicles of roots in which you cut up has now established a new plant. So we want to keep that in mind as well. It's a tedious process in which to remove the roots, but we did that last year. I did that last year and invested like an hour for 20 square feet, and it absolutely worked phenomenal. But it is a lot of time that takes to get the roots out. But once you get the roots out, the years to follow, you're going to have less and less and less weeds to deal with, because you're removing the roots and all the particles of fibers of the roots from that grow area.
But so you saying the compound, you saying that, like the hay that you were speaking on, that's what you were talking about, to put it in there to kill the weeds or not?
Well, with the straw bale, you can just simply set the bale on the ground and then condition it and then plant in the bale. So you wouldn't have any weeds to deal with whatsoever. What's happening with the bale is it's breaking down the conditioning process, which Joel talks about in the book, is creating the internal portion of the bale, turning that into the soil in which the plant is going to feed off of, so you have no weeds at all. The bale is sitting on top of the ground, and you don't even have to till any ground at all.
Okay. All right. Well, that was my question. Okay.
Well, thank you for your call.
Okay. Thank you. Have a blessed day.
So we have an email that has come in, and it's about chipmunks.
You want to read the question?
I can read the question. What do you do to keep chipmunks out of your garden? This is my problem. This is from Deborah.
So one thing we would recommend is to use Bobex, which is a animal repellent spray.
It's the number one on the market.
Right. And it's safe. It's not going to...
Organic. It's organic.
Thank you. And so what you can do is you can spray it around your plants, and that will help keep the chipmunks away. You can also, if you have problems with deer, you could take some string and soak the string in the Bobex and then put it around your plant. You just want to...
You don't want to open the Bobex in the house or in a car unless you have people there that you don't like.
It has a kind of a vinegary garlic smell.
Right. It works phenomenal.
Right.
It works wonderful, but the problem is it's not nice for humans, and if it makes us uncomfortable, it definitely will make the herbivores and the deers uncomfortable as well.
And if you are having problems with animals digging up your bulbs... that you plant in the fall, you can dip your bulbs into the Bobex before you plant them, and that will help deter them from digging those bulbs up.
So with that being said, that was we will have more opportunity for questions next week, and you can always email us at twvgradio@gmail.com with any garden question. You can visit our website, thewisconsinvegetablegardener.com. We have 800-plus videos, short and long length format for your viewing and educational purposes, full-color digital magazines, as well as a bunch of other stuff. And you can find all the sponsors that make this show possible on the radio tab. And, you know, we worked very hard to acquire the funding for this program. And Holly and I have a lot of faith. And you may not believe in God. We do. And that's the reason why we believe we're here today for the next 34 weeks in order to help educate you more. And we have to make mention of our executive sponsor.
Nasala Kombucha is the executive sponsor of the Wisconsin Vegetable Gardener Radio Show. Nasala is made in Wisconsin with local tea and natural herbs. Look for it in the refrigerator aisle at your local grocer. If you don't see it, ask for it, because if it's not Nasala Kombucha, it's not kombucha. For more information, visit nasala.com.
And we will see you hopefully at Brookfield this Thursday at 7 o'clock, the public library, where we will do a talk on growing in straw bales. And if you have a garden group, club, library in which you would like us to come talk, you can send us an email or visit the website, thewisconsinvegetablegardener.com. For Holly Baird.
Oh, Holly Baird.
Yeah. I'm Joy Baird. And until next week, same time, same stations, we will see you in the garden.
WNOV 860 and W293 CX 106.5, Milwaukee.